Welcome to the Planes of Fame. What we're going to do is show you some behind the scenes aspects of some of our aircraft, some of the activities that go on here at the museum, and so on. We'll start right here with the B-17. This is the Boeing B-17. This is a G model. It was built in 1945. Over 12,731 of these aircraft were built. We lost 7,500 during the war to both training accidents as well as combat. This is one of the more important aircraft, certainly in the European theater. It is an aircraft that helped to really turn the tide against Nazi Germany and help the Allies to be victorious in that conflict. She was first designed in 1934, and they built less than 500 of them up until the outbreak of World War II. Then the explosion of production took off, and they were built not only by Boeing in Seattle, but they were built by Lockheed in Burbank and Douglas in Long Beach. And our particular aircraft was actually built by Douglas Aircraft in 1945. The B-17 was what was called a heavy bomber. It has four engines and could carry a bomb load up to 6,000 pounds on a typical mission. It had a crew of 10. Four of them would have been officers, and they would have been the flight crew, and the other six would have been enlisted men, and they would have formed the combat crew. So we're at the aft of the B-17, and this is where the tail gun position is. It's two twin 50 caliber machine guns operated by the tail gunner. He has a gun sight. He's literally sitting on a bicycle seat and kneeling most of the time. And his job is, of course, to protect the aircraft from any attacks from behind. So the first thing you notice when you come inside of a B-17 is they're not built for comfort. They're really not very big inside. In fact, I'm lucky to stand up here. It's very thin-skinned, and there's very little armor plating, so there wasn't a lot of protection for the crews. These missions that they would fly would last anywhere from 6 to 8 hours. And they were flying at altitudes of 27,000 up to 35,000 feet, where it's very cold, below freezing temperatures. There's a story that if they were to take their heavy glove off and touch the side of the plane, their hand could easily stick to the side of the plane. It's that cold. In fact, you'll see devices like this, where they actually could plug in an electrically heated suit. They had these bunny suits that they could wear with electric wires through them. And so it's like an electric blanket. They could keep themselves warm that way. They had a mission to go bomb a target, typically in Germany. And they had a job to defend this aircraft. And so they would use machine guns. This is a 50 caliber machine gun. This one would have been used by one of the two waist gunners who would have been on board. There would have been another two 50 calibers way in the back at the tail gun position. And the ball turret gunner had two twin 50s in an automated turret. The radio operator also had a 50 caliber machine gun. And then there was a number of guns up in the forward portion of the aircraft we'll look at in a little while. But this is where a waist gunner would have been positioned. His job would have been to protect the aircraft from any attacks to the side. Each gun could fire about 700 rounds a minute. On board the aircraft are over 6,000 rounds of 50 caliber machine gun bullets. So they had an ample supply, but they had to be sparing in how they used it. So they fired in short bursts, and the idea was really to send a message to any enemy fighters. If I were you, I'd stay away, because I'm going to shoot at you, and you're not going to like it if I hit you. Likewise, the fighters are trying to take them out, and they're being attacked from the ground with explosions of shells known as flak, and the flak could literally penetrate right through the skin of the aircraft. So again, a very dangerous job. We lost a great number of B-17 crewmen throughout the war. They exemplify the sacrifices that we as a society ask our veterans to make. And so we want to honor these men. That's part of what the mission of Planes of Fame is all about, honoring our veterans, our aviation pioneers. And aircraft like the B-17 that you can come and visit is an opportunity for you to really experience a little bit closer to what they went through during that period.
So this is the Sperry ball turret. It's on the underside of the B-17. And the ball turret gunner would have literally been inside this. He would have been in somewhat of a fetal position, if you will, the entire time. He wouldn't have been in the turret on takeoff and landing, but he would have been in there for most of the flight. One of the more common questions that we get asked by visitors to the museum is, these missions were 6 to 8 hours long. How did these guys go to the bathroom? And typically what they did is they would open the bomb bay doors and they would relieve themselves on that. And unfortunately for the ball turret gunner, that meant that his windows would get coated with frozen urine. And wasn't a real pleasant experience. In fact, our ball turret gunner that we had for many, many years here, Wilbur Richardson, finally got fed up with his crew. And so he built a relief tube that went off further aft of the aircraft so he didn't have to put up with that.
So we mentioned the altitude that they flew their missions, anywhere from 27,000 up to 32,000, 33,000 feet. We as human beings need air to breathe. And the higher we go in altitude, the less air there is. And when we're up at altitudes like 27,000 feet, we are not able to breathe. And so we have to be on oxygen. Typically, they would go on oxygen as high as 15,000 feet. And so this yellow tank here is the oxygen tank for the ball turret gunner. And they're located all throughout the aircraft, and this is how the crews had to breathe while they were on their mission. So not only is it 6 to 8 hours of flying, a good portion of that they're on oxygen. And it's cold and it's miserable and this thing is shaking, rocking and rolling, and people are shooting at you and trying to knock you out of the sky. So was not at all a fun experience for any of them. And for many, many years, they never talked about it. As we move into it, I'm moving into the radio operator's area, and this is where he would have sat here, and he had radio controls. His primary mission is to communicate with other aircraft and as well as control the intercoms so the crew could communicate to one another. He would open this window, and he had a retractable gun that he could fire aft through a top position. So any dangers that might be coming from above, he had the ability to help defend the aircraft from that as well. This was a job of a young man. The average age of a B-17 crewman was 21 years old. So these are very young guys, far away from home and flying very dangerous missions. So again, I can't stress enough how much we owe the debt of gratitude to them. So I'm actually walking through the bomb bay. This is where the bombs would have been kept, and the doors below me would open up and the bombs would drop out. Again, typically between 4,000 and 6,000 pounds of 100 pound bombs or even 1,000 pound bombs would have been used. This is very tight quarters. Here we are in the year 2020 and I have a little bit of girth. The guys of World War II were much smaller, and so they could do this easier than I'm able to do it. And watch me get stuck in the bomb bay and I'll be a permanent attraction here. I made it. So again, there are, it is a small little big plane. So we're on the flight deck of the B-17, and the first thing we notice is this unit here. This is where the chief engineer actually operated the top turret, two twin 50 caliber machine guns on an automated turret that would spin. And so he could protect the aircraft from above by sitting in this chair. And then we would have had the cockpit itself. We would have had our pilot in the left-hand seat, and seated next to him in the right-hand seat would have been the co-pilot. And our aircraft is under restoration, and this is not what the cockpit normally looks like. They would have had twin yokes, and they would have controlled that. The aircraft, they move the yokes forward, backwards, and then turn the wheel to the right or left to operate the various ailerons and elevators. They would have had rudder pedals as well. They would have had a number of controls for throttle and mixture. And then the whole dash would have been filled with instruments that they would use to fly the aircraft. It really was an aircraft that required two individuals to fly. The pilot did most of the actual flying. The co-pilot is operating everything from landing gear to feathering of engines and also maintaining the fire control system for the engines. So very much dependent upon both pilots to operate the B-17 on a mission. And they would alternate during the course of the mission because it was such a long period. But they're also flying in very tight formations. A lot of the missions they would fly would have involved hundreds of aircraft. So it was not uncommon for as many as 1,000 B-17s to fly together on a single mission, all in formation. They flew in what were known as box formations. It provided the most protection from enemy attack. And sometimes these formations might span dozen miles or more. And so literally the sky is filled with B-17s. And there are stories of people, and we've had one in particular. A gentleman told us that his father was actually a conscripted laborer for the Nazis. And he remembers looking up and seeing the contrails of hundreds of B-17s flying overhead. And his father reported, "That's when I knew that we were going to be freed, that the Germans didn't have a chance because they saw so many contrails coming in to Germany at the time." Again, you had to be a tiny little guy, mm-hmm. and it was not built for comfort. So we've literally crawled into the nose of the B-17, and this is where two of the officers would have been positioned. We would have had our navigator. He has a table here, and he would have had charts and the sextant and various instruments that he would have used to help guide the aircraft to its target and then back to its base. And then I'm seated in the bombardier seat, and he would have had a device known as a Norden bombsight. And this would have been what he would have used to locate the target and to actually guide the aircraft over the target, at which point he could release the bombs, or in some cases, allow the Norden to do it. They would have had machine guns. You can see a 50 caliber machine gun here out of the nose. There would have been another one on this side for the navigator. And then there would have been a remote device for the two twin 50 calibers on the chin turret. They found the most vulnerable aspect of the B-17 was a frontal head-on attack by German fighters. And to combat that, he did some field modifications and then ultimately resulted in the installation of the chin turret on the B-17G models and some of the Fs. If you look at the other nine men, their whole mission is to get this bombardier over the target so he can do his job. And so it was a very dangerous job. You can see it's a giant plexiglass window, very vulnerable to any of the attacks that might happen to it. So we lost a lot of bombardiers and navigators on a lot of these missions. So the B-17 lives on in legacy. Today, there are less than 50 airframes really around the world. And unfortunately now, there's only fewer than 10 that are flying anymore. And those four turbocharged Wright Cyclone engines make a heck of a noise. It just sounds like power. It's just, they're a beautiful aircraft to see fly.
If you liked this video, please subscribe and leave your questions or suggestions for our next video in the comments below.
B-17 bombing missions were as many as 1,000 B-17s at one time.
I'm so sorry.
So we have literally crawled up into the nose. Sorry.